Okay, folks, we have batteries now, but the speakers don't work anyway, so I can dab on these as much as I want, I can turn up the volume as much as I want, but nothing's happening. So you will all have to listen, and I will have to yell. Quick announcement. So I just updated the auto grader to show you the output of your commands, because so that way to help you debug. It should also show you any error messages that occur as well. So, is that true? Maybe not. I may have to fix that. But I did this right before I came over here. But as you can see, so this is my little test case. So it's showing you all the output of your program so that you can compare it with what should be out if you did pass the test cases. I also installed Rust, I think, but somebody will have to check that. I just installed the Rust C package. I don't want to do all that other shenanigans, so we'll see if that works. Any questions? Very hard to hear me.
Oh, hello.
Right? Yes. And then it's saying like your username doesn't exist. So the other trick is, so you can specify environment variables on the command line before the parameter or before the command that you want to execute. So you can type your WeChall name here and then space and your WeChall, I think it's token.
Yeah.
And then run the command, and that should work without having to transfer anything over. It's nicer if you transfer it over, but this is a little trick that should just work without needing to do that. Yeah. Ooh. Okay. Yeah, that's a good one. So you have to make sure it matches exactly, right?
So, do you know if, would it matter if you use bash instead of ZSH and you define those variables, would it still transfer over?
Possibly. It depends on your setup.
It depends. Okay.
I'd have to look at it. Yeah. Yeah.
Does the auto grader result, like what our grade will be?
Yes. Your auto grader result is what your grade will be. Yeah. Cool. All right. Move on. Okay. All right, how about this?
we trust that a system is secure?
How do we trust that a system is secure, right? So this is kind of, can we ever trust that a system is 100% secure? No, right? So we need assurances. We need to kind of convince ourselves, and we need to think that kind of, in some sense, it's not a binary, you trust or you don't trust it, but how much do you trust the system? And we kind of ended on, can this be quantified? So what do you all think? Can you put a number on assurance? Would you want to put a number on assurance? Why would that be important or interesting? Yeah, that's great. So you can compare different strategies. So you can say, well, if we go with route A, it costs $1 million and gives us X level of insurance. But if we go with option B, it costs $10 million but gives us 2X assurance or whatever you want, right? So you can actually see what the return on your investment for your money would be. Yeah, that's great. What else? Why else would that be nice?
It enables for competition between like different security systems and providers and whatnot.
Yeah, you could actually like measure how effective a security mechanism is and say, okay, if you implement this security mechanism, you'll increase your assurance by Y percentage. And it would be easy to compare these things instead of just having vague promises about what they should do and what they do. Yeah, what else?
You can set requirements, like a bank has to be some percentage secure.
Yeah, so then you could maybe have a standardized mechanism of depending on the different requirements. So a bank would need a higher level of assurance than just a standard maybe website versus a military installation needs higher levels of assurance than other things. The problem is it is very difficult to quantify this. So this is why classes, if you're able to solve this problem and come up with a way to quantify this, you will be a very rich, wealthy person who has made a good contribution to society. So go ahead and think about that and do that. It is a very, very difficult problem to actually quantify these things. Cool. Okay, so then if we can't quantify it, then how do we increase our assurance? So what kind of things can help us increase our assurance in the security of a system? Testing it? Yeah, so kind of standard things you can think about, software engineering ideas, how do you know that your software does what it's supposed to do? Right. So if that's what you're testing with quality assurance, with software engineering and software testing, then what are you kind of testing in terms of security? Yeah, so break it, or does the system not do what it's not supposed to do? Is there any maybe known vulnerabilities or other places where the code is buggy that lead to compromising the security of the system? What other ways can we increase our assurance?
By setting specifications as to what you want your security mechanisms to be.
Yeah, so setting specifications, so being explicit in our policies, maybe starting all the way up at the top, right? Analyzing our policies, are our policies doing the security goals that our organization wants? Do the mechanisms that we have in place actually appropriately implement those policies? If you think about in software, you think about at the design level. So is the system designed securely? Is it implemented securely? Is it delivered and configured securely? We'll get to all those in a bit. These are great.
Yeah, so then we can think of, and we'll start focusing a bit more on software here because I think it's a lot
easier for us to draw those analogies because you're writing a lot, well, class software and those kinds of projects and stuff. So what is a specification for a software system? Yeah.
Like requirements?
Yeah, requirements, what does that mean?
What customer wants?
What the customer wants? Yeah, or what is the system supposed to do, right? So it could be through what the customer wants, it could be various other avenues. And so how do you define specifications? Anybody have first-hand experience working at a company? Maybe you can share how you did specifications. Yeah.
We worked with like our users to just talk about like what they needed, and like we had a ticketing system
mm-hmm.
that we would use anytime that we wanted to develop a new system. We would pull like relevant tickets and look at like any commonalities they had.
Okay, so talk to the users, then create tickets in a ticketing system based on kind of what they're asking, what features they're asking about, and use those to kind of abstract up into maybe some specifications or a roadmap of what things we're going to deliver. Yeah, what else? Anybody have other experiences? Yeah.
National standards and policies.
Cool. So yeah. So maybe applying national standards or policies. So you can think about. Depends on what the system is. If it's an aircraft system, there are certain standards and levels that you need to achieve. So maybe that drives our specifications, right? So, and then we can also be thinking, and we should be thinking about security even here at the specification level, right? So why is that important? Yeah, so you have a clear idea of the problem that you're trying to solve, you understand the context of the system in the broader organization, and also, so you've written software, right? Is it easier to change a piece of software or to change a Word document about how a piece of software should work? A Word document, right? It's a lot easier to change before anything's actually built, right? So this is why it's really important to be thinking about security at the early stages of a software development lifecycle. Way easier to catch errors here, or maybe even note certain things that must be part of the specification. You can add security requirements to the specifications, and so that those are implemented and tested as we go on. Cool. So then after that point, then we need to design the system. So then how does design work generally?
Prototyping.
What's that?
Prototyping.
Prototype, so maybe making a one-off prototype that does kind of just to get the feel for what the system is supposed to do. What else? Maybe a mock-up would be another thing. Yeah. So some kind of iterative process where you're designing and that helps refine the specifications. It's kind of sounds a little bit like the living document that we talked about. Finding the specifications based on what you're learning as you're developing that. Yeah, what else? So what kind of security problems can come up in the design stage? Yeah.
Like how to protect from unwanted access or unintended access to
Yeah, so how to protect it from all those threats that we talked about, right? You can think through all those threats or threats that are specific to your system, and you can say, okay, what is this design doing to protect unauthorized access, right? What is your system going to do to prevent somebody who's not an authorized user from accessing your data, right? If you just say, well, we have a database and the power
got to live up to them.
Yeah,
things
so
get changed later, then you got to know what to change.
Yeah, so you can think about it in a contractual manner, right? Of thinking like, okay, if the specifications are literally coming from the customer and they are a contract of what you're going to build, then you need to make sure that design satisfies those specifications. Also in security aspects too, right? If there are security requirements in the specifications, you need to be able to understand how those can satisfy that. So how can we prove that a design satisfies the specification?
You can test it.
You can test it? Does testing prove anything? What can testing do? What was it? Maybe give results to analyze? What else? Demonstrate some functionality. If you're going to design, you don't actually maybe have functionality. Yeah, in the back.
You can quantify it.
You can quantify testing, helps you quantify how many test case passes. Does that prove, though, that the design follows the specification?
If you have a standard of criteria that's quantifiable, then by showing that it exceeds that criteria, it exceeds that quantity.
There you go. So if we have if you're handling credit cards, the credit card companies have requirements called PCI compliance, and there's a number of things that you have to do to be PCI compliant that if they're going to trust you to store credit cards. So maybe those are part of your requirements, so you can validate the design against those requirements. Yeah, that's good. Yeah.
You might have your specifications might be written as like acceptance tests. So if you're passing those acceptance tests, you're meeting the specifications.
Yeah, so maybe, we don't have a system yet, so we maybe can't test it. Well, we can certainly test the design, right? I mean, we can think, we can create test cases of does the design satisfy requirement X, or how does it do that, or something there. Yeah.
Third-party audit or review?
Third-party, yeah, so we can hire a third-party to audit our design, right? And they can say, does this design match the specifications? Yeah, the point I wanted to get to with testing, so testing is a great tool. Testing can't prove that something is secure, but it can definitely disprove that it's secure, right? If you find a test case that allows you to violate the specification based on the design, then you've definitely found a massive vulnerability in the system. And again, the important thing is before maybe even any code is written, by fixing it early in the design phase, that will save you a lot of time in the future. Awesome. Cool. Then we have to actually implement it, right? So we have to write code, build something that does what the design says it should do and what the specification says it can do. So how do we know that the implementation satisfies the design? We can do some of the things that we're talking about, testing, right? What else? Yeah, we can manually verify and go through our specifications list that it actually does these things. What else?
Customer satisfaction.
Ooh, we can ask the customers. Yeah, where did that come from? Sorry. There, thank you. We can ask the customers, right? We can maybe put a prototype in the customer's hands and see what they think about the system. Are they going to be able to tell us any of the security requirements? Probably not. It depends on who the customer is, right? But we definitely want to do that in terms of functionality, right? Yeah, and then we can use other things that we talked about, right? We can use hiring, the same things that we talked about in design apply here. Hire third-party companies. We could, ourselves try to analyze our system for vulnerabilities in the actual implementation. And then we can hopefully fix them before we've actually deployed them. And now is this it? So let's say we've done a really good design of our specification, we've looked at it from security angles, we looked at the design of our system, we analyzed it, we had experts look at the design before we wrote any code, we coded the thing up, wrote a lot of test cases, we wrote acceptance cases, we put it in the hands of users. Is the system then, do we have a high assurance that it is secure? Do we want to vote? I mean, this is what clickers are for.
Yeah. Do all those things we can say probably on the
something or whatever, and I ran a command to change the permissions on all the files on that system to be world readable, writable, and executable, like chmod -R/777, so just, and it fixed the problem. Like, all the permission problems went away, except I log out of that system, and I couldn't log back in because my SSH key was world readable and writable, which SSH will not allow you to do, and it blocked it me. So I had to file a ticket to get access to the system, and they were like, yeah, it shouldn't look like this. So even if, let's say, I had or I got an app that was 100% secure, if you throw it in an environment where people misconfigure it, right, you can introduce security vulnerabilities that were not anywhere in your specification or design or implementation, right? So this is why it's important to think, not stopping at the implementation, but thinking through to deployment, configuration, and operation, right? You could have, like in my example, you could have the best confidentiality is really important to your application. You're very careful about hiding user information, but an administrator didn't know it was having errors when they installed it, so they just made permissions, all the permissions, everyone has it, the app now works, but you have these huge security holes that you didn't have in the design of the system. So we kind of, again, have the same thing of how is the implementation deployed, configured, or operated, right? And so, you know, in thinking through real systems, these are real important critical parts, and this is why when we talk about hiring a third party, like hiring a specifically for software or a system to do a penetration test, you bring in a group of hackers that you hire, and they try to break into your system as it's deployed, right? So they're trying to break into the real system as it's deployed and configured and everything, because you don't want to rely on these assumptions of how it's going to be deployed. You want to test the real system. So what are the other ways we could maybe prove or increase our assurance that now at this stage it actually is secure? Yeah?
If somebody reports problems, we can fix them quickly.
Yeah, well, we sure hope so.
Yeah.
So this is one of the massive things, and that's even thinking about in terms of thinking about the specification, right? So thinking through, well, what happens if somebody yeah, we want to revalidate those assumptions and make sure we're not just assuming that it's secure when it's deployed. We want to actually test, is it really secure now that it's deployed? Yeah.
Maybe a way to fix this, like during deployment and configuration especially, is like a pipeline system such that like if a change is made by a developer, it gets run through that pipeline, gets sent back to the developer if it fails. And that way, something isn't deployed that would break the system.
Yeah, that's good. So we can maybe include, let's say, in our development and deployment pipeline, if we include security tests or security assurance into there, we can maybe at least, hopefully, not reintroduce a vulnerability. So there's actually a great bug. I think it was 2011 that Dropbox had. So anybody use Dropbox? You store anything important on there? No? I store everything on there. Literally, my whole computer is on Dropbox. I just work in my Dropbox, so it automatically backs it up, everything. Anyways, you would probably think that one of the core security mechanisms or security policies of Dropbox is you can't log in as another user. Thing. If only the YouTube logs in, should be able to access their stuff. It turns out they accidentally pushed a fix or a bug. They thought it was a fix, but it was actually a bug to their website where they stopped checking passwords. They just accidentally left it so that you could log into the website and with any username, and it would just was an email address, and it would just log you in no matter what password you put. For that, you know. In their credit, it was only around for, I think, like 5 hours, and they had logs of everyone that this happened to so that they were able to alert them. So why do you think a bug like that got through? I guess one thing is, do you think Dropbox does not have any tests?
I think they were biased.
Yeah, I think bias is really important, right? They probably have test cases that test login, right? They say, hey, create a user in the database with this username and this password, and then try logging in with that username and that password. So would this behavior pass that test case? Yeah, because you can log in with that username and password. You can also log in with the same username and a different password, right? So the problem is not having those negative or those security test cases in there really can let these types of vulnerabilities through, and that requires a different kind of mindset when you're thinking about writing a test case. Anyways, I think that's relevant to the discussion about adding security tests as part of the pipeline. And maybe also the other way of thinking about that is maybe don't do a lot of assurance testing unnecessarily on the implementation, but maybe wait until you have a deployment or maybe a staging environment that is very, very similar to your deployment that you can test on. So that way you can catch those kind of issues. thing that kind of underlies all of this, and this is the, I think if you come away from this class and you just say, well, security is incredibly important, and therefore it is the most important absolutely thing ever, I think you'll be at a disadvantage, because I think the key thing is always thinking about this in terms of a cost-benefit analysis, right? Because this is what organizations, this is what real companies have to do, even governments. So it used to be that the government would make their own like CPUs, like silicon and hardware. So why did they do that? Yeah, so that way that no one could solve the hardware bug. They've literally shown that you can create a CPU that if you execute a certain number of instructions, it will give you full access to the computer. So you can be a user space application, you execute these 10 secret commands, and then all of a sudden it drops you down, so you have total control over the computer at the hardware level. Other papers have shown that you can create a Wi-Fi chip that hides the SSID password in the physical noise tolerance of the Wi-Fi signal, so that somebody who knows what to look for can just steal the Wi-Fi password from there. So yeah, these are all the types of backdoors that people can put in the hardware that the government wanted to avoid by making their own hardware. Right? But they don't do that anymore. Why? It costs a lot of money, like not just a lot of money, but like a lot of money. I mean, we have Intel in town here, right? And you think about having to fabricate chips and keep up with Intel and AMD, the literal cost-benefit analysis for them, they said, well, we can't really justify building our own hardware except maybe in very, very specific circumstances. So then what do? What was that? Yeah, so then they have to buy off-the-shelf equipment, but then they now want more assurances from those companies, right? So then they need to think about techniques of how do we increase our assurance that this hardware doesn't have backdoors. And there's a whole bunch of issues there, but so what other factors can we consider this top of the
mitigating or transferring risk?
Yeah, so accepting, can you describe maybe a little bit more?
If a risk costs less than the fix option, then you accept the risk because it's beneficial than spending more than you need.
Right, and we could maybe say that because we believe that the chance of this occurring is very low, right? So we can say, well, accept this risk. It maybe there is a big impact if it occurs, but we believe the probability is so low that it's not worth defending against. Or it could be the opposite. Maybe this is likely to happen, but it's only going to cost us $10,000. So why would we buy a $1 million system to protect a $10,000 problem? Right? What were the other ones you said?
Mitigating or transferring?
So mitigating or transferring risk, right? So what would be, let's say, transferring risk?
Hiring an MSSP?
Could be more specific?
Like hiring a managed security service provider.
Ah, okay, there we go. Yeah. that. So yeah, we could basically either hire another company to do our security for us, only if they would actually accept the risk and liability of something happening, which would be tricky. We could also buy insurance. Right? What does insurance do? Yeah, or in this case, so cyber, you know, I think they call it cybersecurity insurance, right? You could buy that, and you pay, you know, a monthly fee or whatever, and then if there is an incident, they will cover mitigation and those kinds of things. But they also would want assurances that your system is up to some level of competence, right? So they're not going to insure you if you're just not doing anything correctly. So it's an interesting trade-off there. They're not willing to accept the risk unless they can maybe try to minimize it as much as possible. Yeah, so that's, so get rid of the risky parts of your business, basically. You could say, hey, we don't want to become, our business is not accepting credit cards, our business is, I don't know, selling socks online, right? We don't want to worry about credit cards, so we'll outsource that to another company. Like Stripe, which we can include in our web page, it looks exactly like it's us, but we never touch the credit cards, all we get is the money, and that's all we want to deal with. Yeah, so those are great things. The other interesting thing here, actually is relevant, because I did this today. Anybody use mobile ordering on Starbucks app? Sometimes? I don't know what this means. Like, I'm not saying it all the time, but haven't used it ever once. So when they were first developing this feature, they now have this problem of how do we take credit cards in our app? Because now we have to worry about PCI compliance, because this is like the Starbucks head corporation, but all of that credit card information was at each of the branches. Right? So anybody use one of the first mobile ordering systems? Do you know how they solve this problem?
Starbucks cards,
yeah, exactly. They said forget credit cards. They said we want to try to launch this feature. Why complicate it by adding the ability to reload with credit cards? And so you could put your Starbucks gift card. So they used what they already had and didn't basically take on any more additional risk to try this feature. And then when they saw that people really enjoyed it, then they added the ability to load up a Starbucks card from a credit card. Have this information from one of the people at Starbucks. I'm going to try to get him in this semester to talk to you, who runs part of the security for Starbucks, and he kind of told me about this situation they had. Cool. So kind of going along with that, right, we can think about risk analysis. So an important part of maybe trying to think through, well, do we accept this risk? Do we mitigate it? Do we try to have somebody else take it? Is we need to ask, well, you know, we need to say, well, should, let's say, a specific asset even be protected, right? That seems kind of a silly way of thinking. The answer, I don't know, it seems like, well, you're in a security class, the answer should probably just be yes, right? But is that actually true? No, why not?
Resources your business relies on?
Resources the business relies on. You can think laptops, servers, cell phones, basically kind of anything, yeah, yeah.
Anything that has value?
Yeah, anything that has value, right? It could be an asset. It could be the, I don't know, the recipe to KFC's chicken or something, right? That's an asset that they want to protect, I think, or the Coke recipe, any of the other famous ones. Right, so we want to think, well, what threats does it face, right? This is why we talked about threats. This is why threat modeling and thinking about threats is so important. We want to think, well, what threats does this asset or this thing face? And specifically, what are the consequences if it's attacked, right? So we could think maybe, we,
privilege?
Yeah, we can think of like, so yeah, we need to think through what do they need to do their job, right? So the CEO probably needs much more access than the marketing intern. Although now if you said, well, the marketing intern actually has access to their Twitter account, so if somebody hacks into their laptop, gets access to their Twitter account, that can cause actually a big PR fiasco rather than maybe a security compromise. So maybe you would actually think, well, we actually need to secure that a lot. Other examples and the other types of things to think about is, so trying to think of what level to protect an asset, right? If you're going to commit more resources than you have to actually secure an asset than it's worth, then it's probably not very important. And the other question I kind of want to have you think about is, does risk remain constant? So you kind of analyze the situation, say, okay, this is a lot of risk here, so I need to mitigate it, maybe put some policies and mechanisms in place. Required to be kept. department and start yelling about not being able to access their email and that it says their password's not valid or should be valid. And so the IT person would just like, fine, here's a new password, and just change the password. So yeah, you can, you know, it's it can be difficult to quantify risk because it's difficult, I think, maybe always predict what an attacker will do. It's also, I would say, another risk here is that it's hard, it can be kind of easy to justify tweak numbers to make the risk be whatever you wanted it to be if you're trying to quantify things, right? Do we really, can you honestly say you understand the difference between something that has a 0.5% chance of happening and a 0.1% or 0.01? No, at those kind of frequencies, it's so infrequent that it's hard to kind of get an intuitive handle on what those mean, right? And it's easy to say, well, it could be a $10 million breach or it could be a $50 million breach, right? It's hard to predict those in advance, so you can kind of swing those whichever way you want. Anyways, I think there are ways to quantify this. I think it's slightly more easier necessarily than insurance, but it can also be fraught. Okay, last thing I think we're gonna touch on, well, second to last thing in the overviews is we're gonna talk about laws and customs. So why is this important to security? Like if your parents call
Arms Control Act.
Yeah, wow, that's getting, yeah, so, and actually there was a big fight in the 90s about cryptography and cryptographic algorithms. So the US government tried to claim that those were subject to arms control and export laws, but we couldn't export those things, except there was, I remember, there was a weird loophole where, because technically these algorithms are really just math and equations, that you could, but they were trying to classify software as an export that was subject to these arms requirements. What they would do is they would write programs and then print a book of the program, and now a book can be sent to another company because it's just information, not an arm or anything like that. So they would, that's how they would share cryptographic algorithms, is print out a book and send it out to other countries, and that's how they would actually export these algorithms. Yeah.
What they'd do is they'd print them on shirts and classify it as art.
There you go. Or print on a shirt and classify it as art. That's funny. Yeah, so we need to think. Yeah, please. Connecting to what we've talked about, right? So laws can kind of restrict your policies and mechanisms. We talked about companies in the past that have, or not companies, but countries that have laws regarding cryptography. And kind of the other thing to think about here is, so for instance, we can think about, maybe even this is a good case of the talking about Google and Gmail, right? Is it possible for privacy laws to restrict an admin from performing their job, right? The administrator, or you can think about FERPA laws. If you, you know, your data as part of that is also protected under FERPA laws, and if you say, well, hey, I have this problem with my email, an administrator may not be able to fix it, or may have to go through several levels of authorization to get access to your email so they can actually look into and diagnose and debug the problem, right? So it's not a, so we have to be aware of these things because we need to make those proper trade-offs and they restrict basically what we can do. What's the difference between like laws and customs? Yeah. One of the cases where I think this gets really weird is, any of you have a work laptop right now? Yeah? So, can your employer see all the websites that you're visiting? Do they even know for a fact they told you that?
Yeah,
right? Why? Why can they do that? I can't snoop on your traffic, yeah.
Web gateways?
Yeah, so, well, more policy-based because they own that laptop, they're giving it to you as an employee to use, and they, I don't know if they're legally required to let you know, but usually a courtesy to say that, like, everything that you access on this machine we can see. And as we get into cryptography, you'd say, oh, this is crazy, though, but I'm visiting Google.com, and it's telling me that it's secured by Google.com. And they would say, yes, but they own that device, so they can install a certificate on your device that says, trust anything from us, 17 about microchip implants for employees. So a lot of companies, they have like a badge that you use to get into various, you know, access to the building, those kinds of things. This company wanted to put a microchip in your finger that would act as your badge, and so you could put your finger on a door and the door would open, and you could go to the employee cafeteria, use your finger to pay. What do you think about that? Cyborg, so some of you are excited to become part of the team.
Like a bracelet.
Yeah,
just
to
say they can't track your location and do all the things.
Yeah, who cares? We work for them. We have a dystopian
nightmare.
The dystopian nightmare? And what's more concrete than that? Why is it a dystopian nightmare? Yeah.
It complicates when you try to get to other jobs.
Ooh, it can complicate that. How do you take this microchip out? Is there like part of your exit process where they cut open your finger? Or you leave your badge on your desk and you go out and get something. God, that's
What happens if that goes obsolete?
What happens if it goes obsolete? They put another microchip there. Microchip version 2. Now, whatever you, is anyone excited to bring on the pro side of this? AT&T that you don't know about, and then the company has all of the access to every place you've ever been. Yeah.
I like the idea because I worked in IT and I had to make so many badges for people, and it was so annoying.
Yeah,
every
time
I
made
a badge.
Yeah. Every time people forget a badge or lose a badge, or you have to make a new badge. So yeah, it's super interesting. Yeah, more people.
So now you're stuck with the idea that somebody can hack your finger.
Now you're stuck with the idea that somebody can hack your finger. That's true. What are they gonna do with it? You say they can't hack your card?
Using a fingerprint wouldn't do, is my only question for that? Like, because you can just fingerprint.
Fingerprints aren't 100% reliable for everyone. Also,
take a palm scan then or something.
Take a palm scan. That's interesting. Yeah, I don't know, but that may be much more expensive to deploy than using the standard things that are already in like people's cards. Yeah.
It says they have 80 employees at their headquarters.
And yeah, so you need to make that much microchips.
There's like two example things. It doesn't sound like they're actually getting a lot of use out of it. It's like swipe in the building or pay for it.
Is that even updated since? I haven't looked at the updated thing, but I think they still have this program in place. I don't know. It's just a starting discussion. I have no real opinion on the matter. I think it's scary and super weird, but I also think it's very cool. I read this story about somebody who implanted a magnet under their skin, and so they could feel magnetic fields, like walking past a power generator, because the electricity generates a magnetic field. So they like developed this sixth sense of detecting magnetic fields. That is super cool to me. Anyways, okay, the final thing we need to think about in terms of security is the humans, right? So we've talked a lot about systems and mechanisms and policies, but at the end of the day, humans are involved in a lot of these processes and procedures, right? So we want to know who is responsible for security in an organization, right? How does that impact what you can accomplish?
Person who's accountable for security doesn't have a lot of influence in the company, their advice might be like not heard by the top people or just ignored outright.
Yeah, so literally if you think about organizational structure, right, of a company, right, who reports to who and who has organizational power over what, that has a very high impact on what security can do. Right? If security is a subsection of IT, so you have a security manager reporting to an IT manager who reports to the VP of engineering who reports to the CEO. Right, that's a large chain where information has to flow about what security needs, whereas if you have a CISO, like a chief information security officer, who reports directly to the CEO, they have a lot more say in what goes on in securing an organization, right? And specific things like how much budget do they have, right? How much organizational power do they have? That's what we just talked about. Those are super important things to think about. You know, the kind of closing thought here is that we need to be considering people and systems, right? It's not enough to just think about, this is the key thing, is a lot of you are computer scientists and very much computer people, that's why you're going to class like this. It's very easy to think in just in terms of systems and programs, and like we talked about, like automated pipelines with security testing and automated deployments and those kinds of things. But at the end of the day, you have people, right? So when you're thinking about securing maybe something larger than just a software system or even a software system, we need to be thinking about the people that are involved in those systems and what can we do to help them. And it's also like we talked about with the phishing examples, right? Phishing emails are a great example of something that are targeting humans, right? Has anyone ever fallen victim to a phishing? Yeah, some people. I was very, very close. I almost sent Kyle Squires. I didn't almost do that. But what happened was I got an email from Kyle Squires literally right before I was about to board a plane. And it said, hey, I'm in a meeting without cell access, or without access something. I'm in a meeting, like, can you get something for me? Or do something for me, or something like that. And I've actually gotten some, there are some cases where you have to talk to a dean, or like over the phone, or whatever. So I was like, yeah, sure, whatever you need. Like, let me know, I'm about to board this plane. Blah, blah, blah. They responded with, great, I need 10 iTunes gift cards. That's when my flag went up, and I was like, oh my god, I can't do this as a security person. I even like fell for the first step of this. But if you look, like, psychologically, I was in a situation where, like, I had, like, a deadline where I was, like, just about to board a plane. I got an email on the Mail app on the Mac, which by default doesn't show you the email address. It just shows you the person. The layout of the email is exactly like Kyle's emails look like. And so, yeah, I was very, very close. But then when I saw that, I'm like, well, Kyle would never need this. But that's not to say it doesn't happen. smart people that have actually fallen victim to this scam. I know one person who's a lawyer, and they were driving back from a case right around the holidays, and they got an email from a partner that said, hey, I need 10 $100 iTunes gift certificates. And so they drove to the nearest grocery store, bought iTunes gift certificates, scratched them off, typed in all of the codes, sent them, and they said, great, I need another 10. And went and did that, and then it wasn't until a few days later at the holiday party, and they were talking with other people, like, yeah, it's super weird, like, so-and-so asked you to do this, like, why didn't they ask their admin or something to do that? And they're like, oh, no, no, they're not asking you to do that. But, you know, you get even smart people at the right time. So anyways, empathy for users is very important, and I'll see you all on Thursday.
Scratch up. Basically, I wrote a